All right, on this Deep Tech Warrior Meltactor, it's on 18 kilohertz. I think my last video I mentioned it was 19, but it's 18. Sorry about that. But I was going to do some air test using this. This is a 5x8 coil. They're calling it the Super 6 at the factory, or, you know, for the marketing. But it's like a 5x8, so I guess they're just getting in the middle there and calling it a Super 6. But what I want to do is just show you some of the depths I can get with that coil, and then I'll show you some of the depths with the stock coil. But what I'm going to do is this thing just runs ultra smooth, being on this freak. I'm just going to kick it on, and I'll show you. I'm in boost mode, and I got the gain wide open, the volume wide open, and the sensitivity wide open. And I'm just right at about 3-inch Dale reject. And on the ground balance, I'm just slightly positive, almost neutral. I'm going to be in the two-tone mode. But what I'm going to do is just do some quick air tests with this small coil. And I like the way this machine runs like this, because it's right on the edge of instability. I mean, it's really hot. We got to remember, this thing is also running on 8AA's. It's analog type circuitry, so it's a marriage between old school analog with a modern type feel, with the tone breaks, fast, ultra fast target recovery from, you know, say iron to non-ferrous recovery rates, unmask exceptionally well. It's the unmasking of these units is on the level of Gomax Power, Nocta, Macro. It's that type, you know. It's when you're running in two tone or tone machines. I mean, I know there's some single tone machines out there that also unmask exceptionally well, but I'll tell you what this reminds me a lot of. It reminds me of a Tejon with two tones. It ought to be the machine that Tesoro built, but they didn't. I mean, this is, they could take a Tejon, add some tones to it, revamp the battery system where it wouldn't, you know, use so much power as far as killing the battery so quick. They'd have a excellent machine. You know, add just the iron tone. I mean, simple stuff. They won't do it. I don't know why. But this is what this machine reminds me of, is a Tejon running on two tones. And it's a little more powerful than a Tejon, too. So the Tejon's on, what, 17.6. This is on 18. So if you wanted to compare it to something, that's what you compare it to as far as non-metered. But we got the option of having the tones. Okay, enough of that. But what I'm going to do is just a few different targets. You know, dime, nickel, quarter. I even threw a pull tab in, just give you an idea of what's going on the aluminum. But I'm going to check this coil, and I'll come back with the big coil. So here we go. I'll start with the eagle button first. Just a nice, high, crisp sound on this. Very modulated. And I'm going to call it, I can get it out there a little bit, but it gets fluttery. I'm going to say it's 13 on that eagle button. And that's a little bitty coil. Now look, just size of my hand. So keep that in mind. Here's the 58 caliber 3 ringer. Again, just, I love that analog. You can't replace that analog with this digital circuitry that we have on these new machines. So I'm going to call that about 11 on that 58. Nickel. That's going to be a good one to get on out there. And it's going to be right around 13. It's about like that eagle button right there. That's why I like to test a melt detector with a nickel, because I know if they're hot on nickels, they're pretty much hot on them eagle buttons. We'll do a dime. I'm going to call it about 9 3/4 on that. Drop to the copper penny, it looks like. I'd say it's about 10 1/4. Here's the pull tab, double pull tab. Running right in there with the nickel and the eagle button, maybe just a tad less. 50 cent piece. It's going to be about 11. Here's a quarter. But it's a tad less than 11. And here's a big old Morgan here. And it's getting back from the side there at high conductor, but the size is dropping it on back into that 13 range. Let me see if I can grab a piece of iron or something, just let you hear that iron tones working. Here's a horseshoe. I'll let you get a little idea on it for this horseshoe. Remember, I'm on nail reject on a 3-inch nail, and that's a horseshoe now. See, you get that. That's how that. See that? Very telling, and when you're in iron, if you want to dig iron relics, you'll just... That sound right there, them's your iron relic sounds. Them's I love it working through a camp with an auto and with a machine like that, where it takes all the guesswork out. I mean, I can here's a hoe head, you know, the throat. Try that flutter in there, you just know it's. You ain't gotta worry about it. Here's a saddle bracket, you know, a hanger. Just, I mean, you can't beat that for working through relics, you know, on a relic, especially campsites out in the woods, things like that. You can't beat that. You'll go after, you'll leave the nails, things like that, but you'll go after the relic iron with just setting it on a nail break for the disc. And I'll show you a nail when I switch over to the 11-inch round. So I'm going to go ahead and switch over, and I'll get right back with you. Okay, I'm back. Got the big coil on. You can hear it's got a little more chatter with the big coil, but still doable. You can hunt with it like that perfectly fine. Here's the, let's see, we'll do the eagle button. We'll give it about 14. Now look at that, that's an 11-inch coil. That one right over there is that Super 6 look how powerful that Super 6 is compared to, I mean, obviously this is a little deeper, but all I ever see is about an inch more gain from the big coil to that coil. In bad dirt, I dare say, we might get better performance out of that Super 6. About a 12 and a half on the mini ball. It was a 58. Here's a dime. Now take that into note too. I've got a 12 inch dime buried in the yard and it's hitting that. You know, I mean, it's only air testing 13. But that's the way these machines work. They're using the ground balance. How should I say it? The ground balance is like, in essence, is like we're power balancing every time we're, you know, ground balancing. We're not ground balancing in an all metal mode or what like a lot of machines do. What we're doing is we're actually ground balancing to the disc circuit. And that's why when I've got the tone ID on, I can set it to a low tone as being high ground balance setting and a high tone being a low ground balance setting. So if we can get that real close right there, any little thing in the ground that's non-metallic to the full depth, as you can see, will alter the ground balance circuit. So it reports in the audio. I mean, it's if you just dropped way back and thought about it, it's a lot the way a ground balancing PI works with the tone changing from low to high, you know, by the target. It's not exactly, because it does have a discriminator on it, ain't saying that, but we get those slight variations when we're running across the ground. The hot rocks and iron and things like that will low tone us, like that, you know. But anything that's of a conductor of non-ferrous down in the ground, it's just, it's so, how should I say, critical to the ground balance, and the disc circuit is tied together with these units. So anything that fluctuates that ground balance causes an audio report, like it should. That's why on them deep targets you get that sound, like on that 12 inch dime, I'm not exactly getting like a good lick like you'd think an F-75 would give, like beep beep. I'm getting that whoop be whoop, like, you know what I'm saying? It's like the ground balance is actually out of, well, it is out when it goes across that. It's throwing it off that a target is, and it high tones it. It's a it's a old way of doing thing. I mean, we've done it for years with, like, you know, 5900s, Tahans. Tahans work very well doing that. But what the awesomeness of it is, we've got a two-tone circuit doing it. A Tahan, you know, you don't hear that that low part much. It's a high tone only. So what they've done is incorporated the ground balance to manipulate the disc circuitry. A lot of metal detectors don't do that. I mean, they're powerful metal detectors, don't get me wrong, you know, like I can set anything down here, like there's a lot of machines, I ain't gonna start calling names, but I can just set machines down here, get excellent air test depths. But when I get in the ground, I don't get that manipulation in the disc side, the ground balance effect of the disc side, is what I'm trying to say. Like, take an F-75. You know, it'll probably air test as good as these machines. But what happens on that F-75, even though you do a ground grab or balance or whatever you want to do, you'll notice you could be 20 points off of your ground balance, but be in disc mode, and you don't get that feedback from the dirt while you're in disc mode. You might get a little grunt or something, but you don't get that like this thing does when I'm... Hear that? And that's in the distance. We don't get that. Unless we get way out, we can. But this is so critical, it's linked. The tone and the disc circuitry is linked right into this ground balance system. And that's why you get that depth out of these machines. It ain't that they're exceptionally deeper than any other Melotector. It's the way that they go about doing it. But now if you had a target ID system on this machine, it'd probably suffer greatly. About like the dais, you know, the dais is ground reactive like this machine. So in the dais, you know, they're using a lot of algorithm to get you a target ID out of that machine, because it's hard to do of the way it's processing the signal from the ground balance. So very few machines on the market run like this with this kind of depth. And the depth, I mean, it ain't no secret science or anything. It's just, you know, the way they've developed their machine. They've looked at what works, and they, you know, for depth and plus discrimination, and they just incorporated in the machines. It's nothing fancy. It's just a straight out digger. I mean, it ain't. I wouldn't want to use it in a park or nothing, because the discrimination only goes up to about foil. But the way they've designed these machines, it's a simple principle. Like I said, analog principles, but they've adapted it. And okay, let me get back to the nickel. I'm rambling on again. Here's the nickel with the big coil. I'm going to say it's almost 15 on that big nickel. We'll do the pull tab. About like the eagle button. I'll do the penny. And a quarter. Oh, that penny was 12, I'm sorry. Quarter. About 12. Do the half. About 13. We'll go with the big one. About 14. But I hope you understand what I'm saying about the ground balance circuitry. And when I was comparing it to a PI, of course it's not a PI or anything like that, but you can see how you can get your tone changes by the ground balance going out. You can just see that when I'm ground balancing, you know, just you can get a tone change here. Just see if I got my ground balance too low. I'm too high. It's just how critical it is, you know. You know. But it is going through a disc circuit. Don't get me wrong. It's not like a PI. It is phase shifted and all that. But it's just the way it's so critical. Of a setting for the performance of the machine. A lot of machines, you know, ground balance ain't that critical. It's just, heck, you can get them in the neighborhood and they run fine. If you don't have this ground balance set dead on this machine, or a lot of machines, you know, like a Tejon's one of them, and a Troy X5, you know, you've got to have them machines dead on, or they chatter and just go crazy. Same except exact concept. Analog, it's just been updated with the tones. So maybe this will show you a little more about the Warrior. I'm very impressed with it. And I guess that's all I want to say.